Thank you very much for inviting me to do this speech. I've been here for a week now, testing players, 275 until now, in a global health project we're doing on the BWF. So if I look a little bit tired, that's why. And to give you a little teaser, I will talk about injuries. I'll talk about what BWF are doing on sports science, and I'll talk, at the end there will be something about strip badminton. So just lean back and enjoy. I have no disclosures for this talk, though I would like to say that I have some slides which I've got from a Danish company called Spreno. How did I get to Toronto? Yeah, there are many ways to Toronto. This is my way. When I was under 18, I was number three in Denmark. Some would say I was talented, but I was never in the national squad. And so no one had told me that I could be one of the best players in the world. So what do you do when you are 18? Well, I wanted to go abroad to see something, to experience something. And then my father, he said, why don't you go to the Danish elite coaching academy in Aalborg for a year? And then you can decide if you want to go abroad. So, okay, I gave it a shot. I went to Aalborg and had the pleasure of meeting one of the most fantastic teachers that I've ever met. And he has actually been talking today. That's Kenneth Larsen. I'm just still amazed about the power you have in your talk and about how you come out with your ideas. It's fantastic, Kenneth. After that year, I was so lucky to get my dream. So I got a position as assistant national coach in Germany for a year. And teaching the players, some of the best players in Europe, about our ideas from badminton also taught me that it might be possible for me to become one of the best. So after that year, I started to play professional and did that for 10 years. But after a year, when I started, it wasn't enough for me to play. I was missing something, so I started to study medicine. And half a year after finishing my career as a badminton player, I became a medical doctor. And in 2014, I became an orthopedic surgeon. I've been a member of the Danish Society in Sports Medicine for almost 10 years now, doing education and now sitting in the board and also doing something on sports-related concussion for the Danish Sports Federation. A reason that I'm here is also because I've had injuries, like most of you, attending badminton. I have a hip replacement. I ruptured my Achilles tendon, so I know a little bit about what I'm talking about. So today's talk, I want to talk a little bit about what we're doing in the BWF, Sports Science and Medical Research Commission. I'll give you a short brief, a brief literature review on the most common badminton injuries. And I will talk about more in detail on the most severe badminton injuries, and then I will talk about the global health study which we have conducted during these championships. I have been a bit over ambitious, so I don't think we'll make it to the load and injuries, but if there will be time, we'll talk about that as well. If you can't remember anything from my talk, then please reflect on this. Actually, Kenneth, he was not, none of the two coaches down, Kenneth or Kenneth, they were not coaches for the two above, so it's not their responsibilities that they were injured. But what do you think? Is it the player's fault or is it the coach's fault? Who votes for players? Um, I had a talk with one of the assistant coaches in Denmark, and he said that only stupid players get injured. And it struck me a little bit because I had had quite a lot of injuries. But it made me think, have I really done so many things wrong? I think as a coach, you can do the right things, but if you have an over ambitious player, it can be very, very difficult to control the impact, the load on the player. So it's very difficult to say, is it the player or is it the coach? But I think together you will have to find the best way, because the player knows his or her body and the coach knows something about loading, something about physical demands and what can bring you to the top. So you have to listen to the player and the opposite. So the major goals for BWF are three key goals or overall goals. It is, first of all, to encourage and widen interest regarding badminton research. Secondly, it's to improve the quality and the level or the quantity of badminton research. And third, it's also to contribute to higher safety and higher performance for the elite athletes. We need to do this with the athlete in focus, and then we have to look at physiology, psychology, biomechanics, nutrition, etc., etc. To reach these goals, BWF gives some research grants, and as you can see, it has improved over the years, and it's very nice to see that more and more researchers are applying for these grants. It means that we can get more and more research. One of the research projects is taking place in Leeds, where they try to look at how player development and coaching is done in four of the big countries in the world. And they will try to analyze it and come up with some models about how to produce the best players. Another exciting study is going on in Loughborough under the guidance of Professor Mark King, who is a biomechanic, where they look at smash, how can we improve smashes, what characterizes the ones who do the hardest smash. Very exciting. Another subject going on in Germany regarding para badminton, where they look at the strength in the trunk and strength ratios to see if they can improve rehabs and avoid injuries. BWF also last year conducted a literature review and found that there were more than 850 publications with badminton in the headline or in the abstract. And as you can see here, there are quite a lot in all different areas. My field is badminton injuries, and 101 sounds okay, but if we compare it to football, handball, tennis, other sports, it's a very, very low number. So, what is the evidence? What do we actually know about badminton injuries? Do we know anything? Yeah, actually we don't know that much. We know very, very little. And the evidence is really poor. If you look at this pyramid of evidence, you will see the research with the highest or the strongest evidence is at the top and the lowest evidence is at the bottom. It doesn't mean that the things or the research at the bottom is not worth anything. If that's the best level we have, then it's what we have to react on. So if we look at our the papers that are done in badminton, they all come down in the button on the retrospective and prospective cohorts. So it's not very high evidence, but it doesn't mean that we don't that we can't learn anything from these papers. We definitely can. If we look at the 100 papers, you can see that 50% of them are case reports and others, which, yeah, they're interesting, but we cannot learn that much from it. And then if you look at the green one and the orange one, I think it is, that's actually the one that contains all injuries for elite players. So we only have around 9 to 10 papers around regarding elite players. And from then, there are only 2 prospective studies. So it's not very much to rely on. So to make good preventive measures, we need more good research. Otherwise, when we're just guessing. Guessing can be okay. We can have luck, but we need more to rely on. So it's so important that you guys, as coaches, that you try to encourage your clubs, your nations, to do more research on this injury surveillance. So, one of the papers, which is a retrospective study done in Malaysia, 2005 to 2007, includes around 200 players, junior, mainly junior players on an elite level. And what you can see, they suffered in those 2 years, they suffered almost 500 injuries. And you can say, most of them are mild, they are almost, or more than 90% are mild. And so what should we worry about when it's only 1 to 7 days off? But still, that's a lot. We know that when you suffer an injury, it's the most predominant factor for getting another injury. So it means all these small injuries, they can actually make injuries reoccur. So it can be a bigger problem. If you look at where do these injuries occur, then it's mostly the lower extremities and mainly knees, calves, around the ankle. Also see backs, or the back is also quite often a place where you get the injuries. Actually, earlier, a lot of the papers were talking about it was mainly overuse injuries. Acute injuries weren't that frequent. But if you look at this paper, you can, if you put strain, and fracture together, it's actually 60% of the injuries which are acute injuries. So it's not only about loading and these overuse injuries. A lot of players get sprains and strains. So, BWF, they want to protect and prevent, or protect the players and prevent injuries. And since the evidence is not that big, we decided last year to make a study, and it's very, very difficult to make a global study. So why don't we make it in one country? Okay, then the sample size will be very small. So we have to make it as a multi-center study to get as many players involved as possible. That is very difficult when you talk about senior level because they focus on competition and winning. But we thought that doing a study here at the World Juniors would be the right place to do it. So we had to think, how do we conduct the study? There are different players, gender, genetics, what is interesting to look at, and we would like to know a lot, but to be able to conduct the study and have a lot of participants, we needed to focus on few things. So we focused on a questionnaire where players had to report the background, they had to report which kind of injuries did they have previous and current symptoms and recurrent injuries. And then we would like to do some tests, and we did range of movement in the shoulder, impingement test in the shoulder, we did a range of movement in the hip, and we did some angle dorsiflexion and then impingement tests in the hip. So this study, where we have now included 275, we haven't looked at all the data, so I can't say that much about what we have found, but I can say that the tendency is towards that the Asian players, they are more flexible than the European players. They have less impingement in the hip and in the shoulder. And it will be interesting to look at the questionnaires to see what kind of injuries do the Europeans, Americans have, the Africans, compared to the Asians. And when we gather all the information, we can start to do preventive measures. And hopefully this study can be like some baseline for further studies. So we can do really prospective surveys so we can see what do these players, how do they do in the future? And has it something to do with the injuries that they suffered in the early period of their badminton career? Has it something to do with the range of movement and the shoulder and the hip? It would be very interesting to see. And then hopefully we can make some preventive programs. At the present, in India, they are trying to look at some training programs inspired from the FIFA 11 Plus. Do you all know what FIFA 11 Plus is? It's a warm-up program that FIFA developed, and it has shown if you do this project properly, you can actually avoid as many as up to 40% of injuries. And of course, it could be easy to adapt the FIFA program to badminton, but we don't know if it works. So we would have to look at it and then see if we can adjust things to badminton and thereby preventing injuries in the future. It can be very exciting. Okay, is badminton dangerous? Yeah, it can be for some. How many of you knows a player who has sustained an ACL injury? Please mark, not a player from the television, but in real life. Yeah. ACL injury, it's probably the most severe injury that you can get in badminton. We don't know how many gets an ACL injury, but you probably, when you have been around at the circuit, you'll probably notice that there aren't that many ACL injuries compared to other pivoting sports like football and soccer. But still, the ones that get an ACL injury, it can really be career threatening. So it's just so important that we avoid these injuries. And how can we avoid them if we don't know anything about them? A Japanese group led by Kimura, he has done two papers. One paper regarding 21 players, mainly women players. So maybe it's just a problem for girls. We don't know. We know from other sports like handball and football that the players, the young women, they are very, very high risk of sustaining ACL injuries. So it might be the same in badminton. It looks as if, as you can see in these pictures, that it's the same problem as in handball or other sports, that they land with a high valgus angle in their knee. Most of the players, they sustain the injury in the middle court, in the backhand side, doing a jump like this. So when we know that, we can start to focus on having better technique when landing. When we don't know so much at the moment, we can learn from other sports. We can learn from handball, because they have done a lot of analysis on these ACL injuries. And they have found that some of the players that sustain these injuries, they get it when they do like side cutting, and they just land with less bended knees than the ones that don't suffer any injuries. So just by changing the landing technique to land with more flexed knees, that could maybe prevent ACL injuries, but we don't know. It could be. So we also know from handball that they can actually prevent it by doing the right kind of training. And they have actually reduced the number of of ACL injuries just by following these programs. The same in football. The interesting thing is, when they stop to do these preventive programs, then the ACL injuries goes up again. And we all know that. We are, from nature, we are lazy. So if we don't have any problem, we stop to do preventive measures or preventive programs. But it's just so important that you keep on doing this. I know you have a limited time to do your training, so you have to make priorities. Which kind of injury preventive measures should you do? But I hope that we, in the future, can give you more guidelines on which kind of exercises that you should choose from. Yeah, it's a little bit the same. A potential inverse dose response relationship. So higher rates of compliance, less injuries. Another thing that is very, very important is, if you look at this graph, you can see the blue one are the ones returning to level one sport, meaning returning to their pre-injury sport. And the dotted red one is the one who are not attending. And what you can see is that the blue graph goes dramatically up at 5 months. So it means the players that go back too early, they sustain new injuries in the knee. And actually, from 5 to 9 months, for every month returning too early, the risk of injury goes up 50%. So it means you cannot go back to badminton before at least 9 months, and we would say 12 months. In Denmark, we say 12 months. But if you look at this, you have to go to 15 months before it flattens out. So tell your players, do they get an ACL injury? You're not allowed to get back to pre-injury sport level or pre-injury level in sport before after 1 year. And it's not the time that counts, it's what you can do. So if you cannot pass the test after 1 year, you have to wait 15 months. Okay. Another severe injury in badminton. It hurts. It hurts if you have tried it. Not so much here, but more here. So if you look at the foot position, Kennedy mentioned it a little bit before. Is this the right way to land after hitting on the back line? Is that the way we want them to land? We don't know. I think it is. I think it's wrong to land like this. I think this is why he sustained this injury. But we don't know, so we will look into this. So we will do some analysis in a gate lab, making people land on a power platform and see how much strain will that put into the tendon when you land correct, with the foot pointing out towards the sideline, or when you land like this. So this would be the proper way to land. What about return to a pre-injury level after Achilles tendon rupture? Is it possible? Yeah, again, we don't know. Case reports. Wang Chung Han, I don't think he reached the same pre-injury level when he sustained his Achilles tendon rupture. Tine Rasmussen or Tine Baum, she got better. She won the All England after having had surgery. So it is possible to get back, but still it takes maybe 6 months. So it's a very, very tough injury to sustain. So this is more frequent. So this is really important. It's not because the other things are not important, but maybe you can relate to this a bit more, because this happens everywhere all the time. So, up to 30% of the injuries are sprains, mainly on the lateral part, the lateral ligaments. And it can actually cause a lot of problem. Up to 50%, they get chronic problems. I can't say that's why Victor is out now, but he had surgery in January and he has struggled coming back. He's still playing on a high level, but he has problems. That was all from now. So if you didn't remember anything, then think about this. And I think it says 2-1 for the players. Thank you.